Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:08 p.m. Central Time on the 13th of December, 2017. Sorry for the late start tonight. It is Wednesday night going into Thursday internationally. We are over halfway through the week, and that means we are over halfway through this week's earthquake forecast. If you're new to the stream here, we do this on a semi-daily basis. We recap the seismic events that strike around the planet, and every week on Sunday nights, usually, I issue a 7-day forecast that covers the whole week, telling different areas where to watch, and then we check them off throughout the week, where they hit, and if we miss, of course, we get on and talk about that as well. So we need to talk about a few things that happened today. Today was a tremendous day for seismic activity and for some rare earthquakes that struck. And we need to talk about the largest earthquake of the day before we get into what happened on the west coast of the U.S. But look at this, guys. A new 6.5 earthquake showing up down here at the South Atlantic on our letter X. But you'll notice something. One set of agencies reporting 6.5 at a shallow depth. The other set of agencies reporting a 6.5 at 300 kilometers depth. Well, 300 kilometers depth is an entirely different type of earthquake than a shallow earthquake up at the surface. A deep earthquake means there can be a shallower, larger earthquake, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep event itself. Now, the reason for that is multifold. There's pressure coming up on the underside of the plate that then hits the plate boundaries, which are these fracture zones you see. We have an arrow pointing over to the east. That's the normal flow of pressure. If there is pressure to flow, it normally flows across to the east. However, when a deep earthquake like this happens, it puts pressure up on all sides on the underside of the plate. So take a look at this. See this dome here? Imagine this as a bubble of pressure coming up on the underside of the plate itself. So you see it here represented as a three-dimensional globe down below the plates. And imagine that coming up on the underside and then hitting the plate boundaries, which are fracture zones that go all the way through the plate down to the underside of the plate in the asthenosphere. So let me turn off this shell now that you understand what I'm talking about. The area can be displaced in all three directions. I say three because we have a fracture zone to the north on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. That dome extends up almost halfway. We get to the Ascension Island, just south of the Ascension Island region, and that's our halfway point. We go to the east, and we go to the Prince Edward Island region, all the way over here. So when I'm looking around this potentially deep earthquake, and we have to say potential, because there's some discrepancy between the agencies, whether or not it's a deep earthquake or not. Now, if it's a shallow earthquake, something else will happen. If it's right up there at the surface, right at the fracture zone, the Mid-Atlantic Ridge meeting the South Indian Ridge, guess what will happen? That will go through the planet and come back out at the antipode on the opposite side of the planet. Guess what the antipode is to this location right here, where the X is? We go right through the planet and we come out on the Kamchatka Peninsula, right here where our letter D is. We would see new deep earthquakes pop up here in the next few days on our letter D at the antipode of the earthquake here, if it's shallow. But if it's deep, it's going to be causing a shallower, larger earthquake, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger. 1 magnitude larger takes us up to 7.5. 2 magnitudes larger takes us up to 8.5. Now, the potential of it going all the way up to 8.5 is probably not going to happen. I mean, there is a slim chance it can go all the way up to 2 full magnitudes. The reason that is, there's a lever arm action that's happening where the pressure's coming up and then it pushes out across. And I'm sorry if you hear something running around in here, guys. We got a little cat running around in here. Okay. That's the way it goes when you got 4 cats. They're going to be all over the place. I'm lucky they're not all over this chair. They're jumping on the chair. Anyways, 6.5 striking down here. A deep earthquake could mean a shallower, larger earthquake. I'm watching for 2 things to happen. Since we don't know whether or not it's a deep earthquake or not, there's discrepancy. We have to watch for both to happen. One, if it's shallow, it'll go through the planet and come back out up here with a new series of deep fives. It'll lose about a magnitude, passing all the way through the planet. It's amazing that that happens even, right? Second thing is, if it's a shallow or larger earthquake from this deep event that it's potential, then we're looking at a big earthquake down here on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge going over to South Africa on the Indian Ridge. That's what we're looking at. Now, hey, does any of this ring a bell for my longtime viewers? A deep six in the middle of December? Let me take you back exactly 1 year, and we're in the Southern Hemisphere, relative same location, but pretty far away, here in Peru, at the triangular bend of Peru's border going into Brazil. There was a deep 6.4 at something like 500 kilometers deep. It was tremendously deep. This one's at 300. But still, deep earthquake struck in mid-December. I got on the live stream here, which was running last year, got on, told everybody, deep earthquake here means South America is going to be getting hit by a shallower, larger earthquake, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger. Again, this was mid-December last year. And I got attacked for issuing the warning. People said I was trying to make Christmas money. Okay, whatever. Anyways, we issued the warning, and then 7 days later, just as expected, a shallower, larger earthquake, 2 magnitudes larger, hit an 8.0 right here. And they downgraded it to 7.9, whatever. It was an 8, and it struck right here on Christmas Day. After, again, 7 days before, or 7 to 10 days before, I think it was 7 days before, right here, okay? So, just, again, you're welcome to go fact check me on that. It was 7 to 10 days. I have to go back and check, make sure. So, here we are. We're going to look 7 to 10 days here. And I set the rule back then, when that earthquake struck, that's when we set the 7 to 10 day rule for deep sixes. Right, guys? I mean, people in chat will verify this. You don't have to take my word for it. You can just read in chat. People will be like, hit number one if you remember what I'm talking about here. When we set the rule for new deep sixes, and then it hit on Christmas Day. Well, here we are. We're in mid-December, and we're going to look for 7 to 10 days. 7 days takes us to the 20th. 10 days takes us to the 23rd. Okay? So that's what we're watching for with this big deep earthquake. That's not the only earthquake of the day, though. There was other activity that struck around the entire planet that's significant. You may remember yesterday we talked about how the Pacific was displaced all on a 4.0 level, all within a few points of each other, 4.5, 4.6, 4.7 across the whole plate. Well, look at this, guys. Filling in since yesterday, over to the west and up to the north. So really, if you back this out, in the last day and a half, the whole West Pacific from New Zealand up to Kamchatka, all the way over to Indonesia at Mount Sinabung, technically inside of Toba supervolcano, this four struck. Well, the whole region has been pushed on a 4.0 level, but today, not much, just a few. So really, it was yesterday that got the push. Today just filled in the silent zones. For my Kiwi viewers down here in New Zealand, just as expected, look, now you're going up again. Your threes have gone all the way across the northern catcher's mitt position down to the south tip of the island, and you have a 3.8 striking just north of Christchurch. So, as expected, your twos have graduated to threes. Your threes are now graduating up, and you're getting more of them. The frequency is increasing. Frequency means the number of events. So the number of 3.0s is increasing, and the magnitudes are increasing across the board, across the whole island. Now you're going to notice something here that's down to the south and up to the north. Well, what's the halfway point between these two zones? Obviously, that takes us right in our zone right here north of Wellington, right on the plate boundary. So if we're going to look for new activity to strike, let's look on the plate boundary to the north in between our two sets of quakes. Luckily, the only good news I have for you is that there's not many new deep events. There's a deep 3.7. And the 4.3 is not a deep quake. It's at 150 km. So again, we think anything over 200 is a deep quake. Therefore, you have one new deep 3.7. A 3.7 there is capable of causing a 4.7 down on the North Island. So watch out. You could see a new mid-range 4 pop up in the middle of your silent zone due to that new deep quake striking in your catcher's mitt position. And I call this the catcher's mitt because it looks like one and it also acts like one. as the pressure's coming up, it hits the mid, and of course, then it releases before it hits on the North Island, okay? And like I said, deep earthquakes cause shallower, larger earthquakes. Now, over in the European region, really quick, let's just dust this off. Look what happened today. 4.8, 5.0 earthquake struck in the Aegean Sea. A 4.0, 3.7 earthquake struck next to Istanbul. That's right, not Constantinople. Istanbul got struck by a near 4, and a near 5 struck at the Aegean Sea south tip. But the north tip got hit by a 4. All right, so we were looking for up to a 5 to strike at the north tip, and this is within a magnitude. I would consider this 4.8 to be the earthquake we were looking for. After that earthquake, which is color-coded in a pinkish color, so you can see it's older, then other earthquakes struck downstream. This goes into Bosnia, which was hit today by a 3.1. Check it off the list if you were keeping track of areas that we named. Also, over to the east in Romania, same-sized earthquakes. 3.1, 3.2, within a magnitude of what we're looking for. We're looking for up to 4, and we're getting mid-range 3. Okay, so down to the south, Istanbul, check it off. 3.1 in Bosnia, check it off. 3.2 over in Romania, check it off. And it all traces back to the 4.8, which lost a magnitude going up to the north. Makes sense, right? So 4.8 goes down a magnitude as it travels across that distance, going brute force through all the fault zones and following the plate boundaries overall. Same-sized earthquake struck over to the west if you add these together. 3.9, 3.5, 3.6, 3.7. If you add those together, that equals 4.1. Then add in the 4.3, and that equals 4.4 or 4.5. So in other words, we got a 4.5's energy released across South Italy after the 4.8. So it lost like 0.3 going up into Italy. Now we're going to look for Central Italy to get hit. Not just anywhere. We're going to watch just north of Campobasso, south of Norcia, which puts us right into the Abruzzo range. And there's only one single 2.0 showing up on the European feed. The Italian feed is showing some smaller earthquakes still swarming out in Norcia, but we're talking about a full magnitude and a half increase, so a 10-fold increase in power going up in central Italy, just to be consistent with the rest of what's happening around Europe right now. And it's going to spread across Europe as normal, and it will go out to Iceland for my people out here. So for the people in Iceland, you'll get hit by the same-sized earthquake striking in South Europe, which means in the 4-ish range, more like mid-range 4 at this point, not 3s like last week. So you're going to go up a notch. Again, you're going to go up 10-fold increase in power. Everybody's going up 10-fold increase in power. Look, it's going from 2s to 3s, and we're going to go from 3s to 4s. Why? Iran just pushed a day ago. You can see it over here with the darker-colored earthquake, the older earthquake. The older they are, the darker color they are, for easy identification purposes. So you can see the lighter earthquakes are striking over to the west as a result of the push from here a day ago. And it's going out just to the west as expected. Strait of Gibraltar hit at Morocco. Check it off the list. We name that. And out to the west and towards the Azores. This is in Portuguese waters, 4.0 striking. Now, that's a lot of fours, right? All in a day. So how about the west coast? How about the west coast of the U.S.? How about a 4.0 earthquake, which could go all the way up to 5? If you go check the station locations, you know what? Why don't we just go ahead and go do that together, shall we? Let's go look, pull the USGS feeds here, and see what they've got reported for magnitudes. Now, again, the stations are going to show us a little bit different depending on which station. So the more stations reporting, the better. And when I look across and see what's being reported, okay, we'll go with our, let's go with our local magnitude list. So again, we'll start at the top, 4.5, 4.1. We go down the list, we throw out the highs, we throw out the lows. So if you get tremendously high readings or tremendously low readings, we throw those out. So see the twos and threes, throw those out. We know it's not a two or three. It was something more in the upper four range. So you go down the list and you'll see it is detected as higher magnitudes. Now the highest we throw out, 6.7. And that still leaves a broad swath anywhere in the five range. And they always do this. They'll knock a magnitude off on the West Coast earthquakes for statistical purposes to keep people kind of dumbed down to think that everything's normal. And this would be, if they didn't shave off the magnitude, it would be the largest earthquake in years in the location, right? So to save any big media hoopla and to save any kind of questions being asked, just shave off that magnitude, guys. And that's what they do. And I'm not joking. That's what's done. It's that bad. So science can't be trusted, and the numbers you're getting can't be even counted on. And I've talked about this at length and done whole videos called Science Scandal when we've discovered that the data itself is being manipulated to keep everything low, like de-elevating all the earthquakes to be 4.9s, for instance. We caught that. You know, doing that to keep all the fives away so that when people search next year how many fives happened in December of 2017, of course, it'll say normal, the normal number that just happened within a variation of just a few, right, of the year before, and everything was normal. No. So let me get a sip of my hot cocoa here. Anyways, so the size of this earthquake matters, and it matters to the people downstream from this earthquake. So the people who are downstream look at the arrows and look which way they point, and that leads into California. That leads over into the Midwest. This leads across Colorado and Yellowstone and Kansas, Oklahoma. All of you are going to be getting hit in the next few days. And the total amount that's coming your way is between 4 and 5.0. And I wish I had a better I wish I trusted the information better, but I know what they're doing with the downgrades just to avert questions. So, to avert questions, they're doing that. They won't be able to hide the earthquake that strikes downstream in a populated area. So this is still a populated area up in Washington, and they can do the funny business on one earthquake, but they can't if another one strikes and it causes damage, right? So a 5, let's say, down in Southern California in our warned zone, which we need to get into in a second here. Wait till you see what happened today in our warned zone down in Santa Barbara going into Ventura, California. I'm going to turn it on. Here's the USGS feed of 0.0s and greater. Just look at this. Okay, let me turn down our ring so we get a better idea. Look at this, guys. A new swarm broke out right here in Ventura. And I'm going to go pull the coordinates, and we're going to put them in on Google Earth so I can show you what's there. So here it is. This is just one of them, one of the earthquakes. Just grabbing the coordinates so we can show you what's there. 17 kilometers deep. And we'll use Google Earth to put the coordinates in. I always recommend you do this if you see a swarm breaking out of a spot that was silent. Now, many people out in California already know what's going on out there, but many people internationally might not know that the location I'm zooming in on just so happens to be the location that's on fire. That's right, only 17 kilometers down below. Look what we have right here. So here's our earthquake epicenter, right? You see it with the yellow place mark? Okay, now I'm just going to back it out and go right over the hillside here, and we're going to get to a large pumping operation, just like all the others, guys. So here we are, and we're looking, and you can see, maybe I need to zoom it in a little more for people who are on tablets and phones. See that? The shadow of multiple oil wells up on top of that hillside, and that's not the only one. They go all over, and they pick up over here on the other side as well. This is a large pumping operation. Look how many are up here. Okay, so you get the picture. It's a big pumping operation, and right next to it, we have an earthquake now striking. Also, we have fires all across here, and it's no coincidence. Now, it's confirmed. There's a swarm breaking out there in our silent zone, and that's not the only one. Look at what happened today down in Southern California. LA Basin lit up with 2.0 activity all the way across the basin. Now, I want you to imagine this. How much force do you think it would take to push all of Southern California on a 2.0 basis? Right? It would take a great amount of force. I mean, it's not just a little push. There's something else going on here, and we'll go further up to the north. I think you're going to understand, but first let me explain this. The slow slip at Anza Gap, California, the professionals announced that on October 25th that the plates, Pacific and North American plates, moving side by side, have picked up in pace, and a slow slip is going on right where this stack of earthquakes is. And this stack of earthquakes indicates that there's a pocket moving not just there. We have to look at the other stacks that are occurring. Now, again, guys, somebody wrote me, and I stand corrected. I've been calling, when I showed this section right here, and I've been showing up here at Mammoth Mountain and showing Mono Lake and showing the North Long Valley caldera, and I've been talking about Long Valley caldera extending down to the south, I need to be more specific when I talk about Long Valley versus Long Valley caldera and the other names of the valley as it goes down to the south. Now, people have corrected me and told me, you know, hey, you're talking about Long Valley caldera, it's up here. Okay, I'm talking about the valley that connects to Long Valley caldera, and there's several names that are connected in. It's not just Davis Valley or any of the others. We get in there and there's several names. So when I'm talking about it, for people who live out there, please don't get too frustrated with me. I'm aware of the naming of the valleys through there, but when I'm talking overall, I talk about the Long Valley caldera and the connected valleys between where the volcanic chambers are that go down through here. Again, people are very specific, and I understand. So, you know, I am aware if you're going to write me about it. So, anyways, when we look here and you understand, swarms are happening going up the valley, going to Mammoth Mountain, across the border, going north of Lake Tahoe to Steamboat Springs, and then connecting back across Lassen Volcanic Field over to Clear Lake Volcano. So really, the whole plate is seeing swarms happen at volcanoes. Now, all of these, and I've looked these up before, but we're going to look them up again right now. We'll start down here at the south, and we'll work our way up to the north. Again, I just showed you the pumping operation in North LA. I guess that's technically east of Santa Barbara in our silent zone. So when we get here up to the north, let's go pull these coordinates here. Now, you see the earthquake. I'll mark it in blue. This is a swarm happening here. We'll get the largest of the bunch, and it's called Kozo Junction. And I've already showed this location to past viewers many times. New viewers, please look at the screen, because there's something actually pretty impressive there that's causing the earthquakes. So as we zoom in on the area, first of all, your eyes are going to be drawn to the large black lava flows that extend off of Volcano Peak here, and all the subsequent small cinder cones, or pretty large cinder cones actually, that have broken out over many thousands of years with different lava flows. And this is like, these are domes that are rising that could erupt someday. But okay, so we're looking right over here, and here's our earthquake. And our earthquake is happening right next to an unmarked volcano, not unnamed, unmarked. Now, I didn't put that place mark there. I downloaded these place marks. So again, that's an unmarked volcano. Somebody was doing some research on that on the Google Earth community, apparently. Now, you'll make note of this, the Kozo Volcanic Field. And this is something that they have a geothermal pumping operation at, where humans have drilled in to right here, and they've drilled in. It's called Devil's Kitchen, believe it or not. Yeah, right? I mean, can you believe that? They've drilled in, and they are injecting water that's then steamed off and taken to these steam turbines that provide power to the area. So anyways, earthquake swarm striking there. As we go further over to the west-northwest here, this is at a place called Coalinga, California. And Coalinga, California, the name itself, Coal, Coalinga, Coalinga. And, of course, its name gives away that there's some petroleum or coal there. Well, there's also oil and gas at the location. And the spot we're zooming in on is a very large pumping operation right here. So these aren't ants on the ground. These are all oil wells, guys. And look how big the patch is. Okay, down to the south, up to the north, and we get right to our earthquake. And it's really right off of it. So it's definitely related to the pumping operation. So now we have volcanoes, pumping operations, and the plate itself slow slipping. As we get further to the north, I can just name these out. This is Mammoth Mountain. Mammoth Mountain is a well-known volcano, and I'll show it to you here. And you're welcome to go pull the coordinates on the earthquake itself. Here's Mammoth Mountain, and feel free to read the description. And they have pictures of the cinders. Here's the picture of the cinder, and the cinder that they're showing in the picture is right here. So there it is. If you ever go skiing in the backcountry, I guess you could go skiing on those volcanoes. Don't know if you'd want to, but you could. Dante's Peak style. Okay, as we go over to the east from there, these are at underground nuclear test sites. And yeah, that probably caught your ear if you're a new person here. You're probably like, what? Underground nuclear test site? We're not doing any nuke tests there. These areas become inundated with pressure, and humans have created fracture points in the crust. Now, let me show you. First of all, the highway is right there. But right here is Operation Rise Line, Doomtown, as they call it. And I'll turn on the Google Earth community so you can see. And, you know, they've taken a good amount of time to put all this information together for the community. October 15, 1958, just a small kiloton detonation. That's one of many. And then we have our crater field up here where all the big nuke tests were done underground. And so these aren't spots where they dropped anything, guys. These are spots where they put it underground, detonated it, and it created a cave-in or a collapse ring. There was one that they put in the ground up here at the Sedan Craters, as it's called, because it's marked as a volcano, because it actually blew out. It was either set too shallow or it was more powerful than expected, and it blew out. Isn't that wild? Anyways, that's the spot being struck. I mean, are you starting to get the picture here? The fracture points in the crust are coming under pressure, and they're releasing with swarms of earthquakes. So we go back over to the west from there, and we get over here on the creeping section of the San Andreas Fault, of course, on the South Hayward North creeping section. And then, of course, that's not volcanic. Those are straight fault zone. So those are straight fault zone earthquakes, and they're in a diagonal line indicating such that the fault itself is put under pressure. Now we go up to the east-northeast from there, and we get here. This is South Reno, and in South Reno, at, well, 10 kilometers north of Incline Village, people in South Reno already know about it. It's called Steamboat Springs, and it's a volcanic geothermal field. It's also south of the Needles at Pyramid Lake. But anyways, right here, we are just south of Reno, Steamboat Springs, all throughout here. There's many geothermal events, and they're all have happened throughout here. So that's pretty wild. In the past, there's been many, and they still have it marked as an active volcano. I need to download those place marks as well. But you're welcome to look it up, Steamboat Springs. Now, let's get back over. We go just to the north of there. Another small swarm of earthquakes at Janesville, 12 kilometers east-southeast of Janesville. Well, let's just go look it up since we're looking them all up. Here we go. Right in the middle of a salty basin called Honey Lake, right? Okay, guys, there's actually something else that you need to see right next to it, and that's the large volcanic field, which is, of course, related to Mount Lassen. And all of these are volcanoes going up to Lassen itself. And this is not even up for dispute. Clover Butte is, you know, here's one right here that humans are mining it out. Look at this. So they've come up and started to dig it out. Apparently, there's some precious materials in these old volcanoes. Would you be shocked about that? As we go over to the west, the younger flows are not even covered in trees. Here's Cindercone Butte State Park, and it's just like all the others, only it's not weathered down and covered in trees. As we go further up, you see there's several more in rows. So Potato Butte, and then this one doesn't have a place mark on it, but I'm sure it has a name. There's craters out in here as well. Wait for that to load. There we go. Okay, so you can see that craters nestled in there. Old volcanic buttes, and you see this row. I mean, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, all throughout here, going up, up, up to Sugarloaf Peak Volcano. And that leads us over again. We've got a swarm of earthquakes happening across here. All right. Now, there's one big stack of quakes here, and this is, of course, going up in magnitude and going up in the number of earthquakes. So the frequency is increasing and the power is increasing at Geysers, California. And Geysers, California, I think the name kind of gives it away. It's also Clear Lake Volcano, and this swarms every single day. It's a large geothermal pumping operation where humans have drilled in. Just like at Coso Field, humans have drilled in. See these pipelines? Pipelines take the steam up to the steam turbine. And swarms break out here when California is under pressure. Now that I've proved to you that all the locations on the eastern side of California are volcanic, and all the locations down in Southern California, at least around LA, at least the swarm that we looked at, are either fault zone directly on the plate boundary slow slipping or pumping operations moving. What does that mean? It means that there can't be much more before you get hit down in Southern California with a noteworthy sized earthquake above 4.0 or right at 4.0. Now, how am I coming to that 4.0 conclusion? Well, you just had a new 4 strike today up to the north, and I'm thinking it's a bigger earthquake. So we're going to look in between, right in the middle of this area where we don't have any earthquakes reported. That's south of the creeping section of the San Andreas Fault. Let's include the creeping section going south through Santa Barbara into North LA. So right through here, dead center brings us into Santa Barbara. Okay, and the reason being, again, you're getting pushed from the north. Secondly, over to the east, we have two different locations that are going to be impacted in the next day. More like, 24 hours, maybe 48. We'll see a new swarm break out up here at Yellowstone going into Idaho. So let the people know at Yellowstone, it's nothing to panic over. But when you see a stack of earthquakes show up there, it's a result of the push from the west coast. I'm more concerned about the western slope and front range of northern Colorado. I think they are going to be getting hit along with the Kansas-Oklahoma border region at central western southern Kansas meeting Oklahoma at the Panhandle. I think both of them, Colorado and Kansas, are going to be impacted in the next few days off this 4 coming from the west coast. How much? Well, I think it's going to maintain most of its momentum coming across the plate. In other words, it's going to stay the same sized earthquake, and we'll see a near 4 striking at both locations, all three locations, I know, by the end of the week. So northern Colorado on both sides. Both sides of the mountain range. And I used to live out here out in Denver, so I know people up in Greeley. So up in Greeley, there's a huge pumping operation. Guess what's on the equal side of the mountains on the opposite side of the front range, guys, over on the western slope? Another pumping operation. That's right. And we just looked at it yesterday because it just got hit by an earthquake yesterday. But three, a rare three. Here, you want to see it? Let me show it to you. Let's just wait for this to refresh. Okay, so now you're going to see the past few days worth of earthquakes, and this makes a little bit more sense. See? Multiple threes going down the western portion of the craton edge. And the craton is just a geologist's word for the interior portion of the plate. Let me quickly show it to you so you can see it for yourself. See the graphic here? Okay, the graphic, I put this out years ago. All I did was put the black lines on it. With the arrows. The graphic has been out. It's in publications, it's in books, it's all over the place. So you can see the interior portion of the craton is that orangish-brown color. And then the purple portion is the deformed edge. And look where the line, the brown versus purple, goes through. It goes through Yellowstone, down through Wyoming, and then across Colorado on the Continental Divide, following it down through New Mexico, bending back up into Oklahoma. Now, we have a red arrow going across, well, we've cut that in half, across Texas. Humans have created a perforation on the edge of the plate due to all the pumping operations. That's right, they've done enough drilling on the edge of the plate that it's created, well, an avenue for pressure to transfer out of Colorado. Instead of normally going all the way down through Texas and coming back up and around, it will make a beeline from Colorado over to the pumping operations in Oklahoma and Kansas, which is why we're warning central southern western Kansas and northwestern Oklahoma. And the magnitude should be in the 4 range. It should maintain most of its speed coming across the plate. Okay? So be ready for it. And that all hinges upon whether or not it's a 4. What if it's a 5 and they're underreporting it like I think they are? I have to go with what they're reporting, but man, I think they're under the reporting this. We'll see. We'll see. If we get larger earthquakes down in California and over in the Midwest, you'll know it was a bigger earthquake, right? You'll be able to trace it back, like tracing back the fingerprints to the culprit, to the criminal. okay? And in this case, the push is coming from the northwest and pushing to the east by southeast. Okie dokie, got that? Got that, everybody? Okay, now let's talk about a few other things that are going on. We're going to see some other activity spread out. I would urge you to please go watch my weekly forecast. It was issued on Sunday night. It's over on my YouTube channel. You just have to click back a couple and you'll find global earthquake forecast. And just fast forward it to your area that you're concerned about and watch the warnings. And I can already tell you several of the locations have been hit. Again, we were looking for activity in multiple locations, including Iran. Iran's what started us off this week. So we issued the warning for right here in Iran, and Iran got it right here. Okay, so they got creamed really hard, and then it pressed over to the west, and now Europe's getting impacted. And they're being hit in the locations we were expecting as well. And we're looking for central Italy, Bosnia. Okay, those areas are being checked off. There's only a couple more to be filled in for the week, and we're halfway through it. So we still have halfway to go. And this new event down here, if this is a deep 6.5, we're looking at a shallower, larger earthquake before Christmas. That's what we're looking at. And it could be 1 to 2 magnitudes larger if it's a deep event. So I really wish we could rely on the agencies to give us the proper shakedown on what it is. But as it stands right now, I have to wait and watch just like you with bated breath. Are we going to see the largest earthquake this year in years? An 8.5 would be the largest earthquake in years. Okay, so that's where we're at. And you know, when we get around this Christmas time, it's not that it seems that there's a pickup in earthquakes. There is an increase in earthquake activity around this time of year. We've seen it with the Boxing Day earthquake. We've seen it with, we've seen it over and over again. But Boxing Day earthquake is the one that everybody remembers right around the Christmas time. Most people don't remember last year's 8.0, 7.9, downgrade, whatever, 8.0 that struck down in Valparaiso, Chile on Christmas Day. When that hit last year, and we were all looking for a shallower, larger earthquake, that was the third 8.0 that month in December of last year. And it all started right around this time last year. Mid-December is where it started to pick up, and by end of December, 3/8 had hit. Right, guys? To hit one if you remember, because this isn't me exaggerating. If you're in the chat room, you'll see a bunch of ones start floating by, because if you're a longtime viewer, you'll remember it from last year, and we're going through it again. If there's any new deep earthquakes, and I mean if we see even one or two of them pop up on our letter Ds, and I mean anything over 200 kilometers deep, that's going to be a warning sign that we're going into another cycle as well. So it all hinges upon what happens in the next few days with the deep earthquakes and with this big sucker down here. And let's hope that's all she wrote for the week. For Europe, you're under watch for fours. For the West Coast, you're under watch for fours. And it all hinges upon their reporting. So if it's a five, if this sucker was a five and they're doing that, it's their own you-know-what's on the line, because they live down there and they'll be the ones running around picking stuff up off the ground, right? They'll be the ones who have stuff break off their desks and look like idiots saying they don't know what's coming their way when there's somebody here online trying to show them. So if you want to know how to forecast an earthquake, let's say you're a professional, you're tuned in tonight, you're like, I don't know about this YouTube guy. Okay, I don't blame you. YouTube is totally freaky. There's a bunch of weirdos on here all the time. The only reason I'm on here is because I have to be to reach billions of people to try and put my warnings out. There's no other way. Websites don't work. Apps don't work. Twitter doesn't work. There's just no way to put it on Twitter anyways. It's too long-winded and too many words. So here we are, and I'm doing my forecast. I understand you are skeptical. So let me tell you, you can repeat the methodology simply. If you want to know how to forecast an earthquake, I put out in text how to forecast an earthquake on my website. It's free to view. No special click-throughs for any ads. You can turn on ad blocker and block even the side ads if you want. You don't have to click on anything. Just read, it's a long post, how to, and then repeat the methods. Now, I can explain to you quickly. The deep earthquakes that you see raised high off the globe here, they push up on the underside of the plates. When they push up on the underside of the plates, they create, of course, a force that comes up on the underside of the plates. So it's not just an earthquake on the underside of the plate, it's a force coming up on the underside of the plate. And I want you to imagine that force separately from the earthquakes. The earthquakes themselves are causing shaking, no doubt, and the earthquakes themselves will do what I call brute force, pushing their way through the shallow layers of bedrock and the fault zones that are up towards the surface. But this greater seismic force causes the earthquakes. The earthquakes are the fingerprints of this greater seismic force. And the earthquakes that are deposited along the way as the force travels across the planet in certain directions, they give us a good idea of what's spreading across the planet. It's just basic 101 logic. So, in other words, this force starts in the West Pacific from a deep earthquake or series of deep earthquakes. That's why this deep earthquake over here matters. That's why it matters whether or not this one's deep. If this one's deep, it's super rare. It's the only deep earthquake we've ever seen down here in the 7 or 8 years I've been watching. That's how rare it would be if it's a deep earthquake. So, I digress. These deep earthquakes push up on the undersides of the plates, and then the pressure follows a path of least resistance coming up on the underside, up through the plate boundaries. Now, the reason is the plate boundaries are fractures that start at the surface and go down all the way through to the asthenosphere, to the magma. So, in other words, the pressure has an avenue to follow. It follows these cracks in the plate boundaries like an avenue, a road. And you can see along the way, you can connect the dots along the plate boundaries, and the greater push you get over here, the greater movement you get on attached plates that are butting up against. The reason the United States gets hit with much less than what comes out of the West Pacific, brute force, these earthquakes have to push all the way around to the East Pacific. We're on the opposite side of the plate from where all the deep earthquakes are happening. If we started to see deep earthquakes on the West Coast, that would then lead to what's going on over here. Over here. But we're not seeing deep earthquakes over off the coast of the United States because of the shape of the plates and the way they are locked together on the Juan de Fuca and, of course, all the way down the West Coast. So the plate structure here is different, which, of course, doesn't allow for subduction. And that's a whole nother story on a whole nother thing that we could get into about how the West Coast is not subducting. They are butted up against each other, and the Pacific plate is more like a bathtub bottom, and California is more like the bathtub side. And they're both meeting up against each other and moving side by side as opposed to up and down. And North America is being pressed upwards over a long period of time by this side-by-side wedge motion. And the Pacific plate isn't going underneath the North American plate. Guess what's underneath the North American plate, guys? Guess what's underneath the North American plate? Magma! There's not another plate going down underneath our plate. That's a false sounding based upon reflections that are coming up at an angle done by earth-penetrating tomography and study of seismic waves that can be entirely explained by the Pacific plate literally just being side by side with the North American plate. Like I said, like a bathtub bottom. Imagine this. Imagine a bunch of scientists sitting outside of a bathtub. And they've got some very complex seismic gear and some earth-penetrating tomography gear. And they're sending vibrations through the bathtub, and it's vibrating through, and then it goes down and around, and it vibrates the underside. And they say, see? The bottom of the bathtub is going underneath the side of the bathtub. And then you get in it, you're like, no, it curves. No, it curves. It's all one. It's all met up right there. It's all one plate meeting. And then they're sliding side by side where there's fractures that have occurred. That's it. So any soundings that are happening on the underside are only coming from a reflection off the Pacific plate, not from subduction. Do you follow me? So they need to get their heads around that. Once they understand that, then they'll understand that the fracture zone that's out here, the Juan de Fuca fracture zone, the Z-shaped, Harry Potter-shaped fracture zone the lightning bolt shape, whatever you want to call it, it is, of course, caused by compression, not by subduction. Compression from two plates moving side by side, which would then cause lateral quakes and upwelling pressure to come up and cause folding in the plate, which would then cause the tsunamis that they've seen that happen over long periods of time. In other words, another explanation for the whole story. I just gave it to you all in a nutshell in like 2 minutes. You can tell I thought about this for a long period of time. I don't get much time to talk about it with people, but it's just something that's been knocking around in my head for a long time about the West Coast. Okay, so you understand where we're coming from. You understand that the pressure starts here, and now you understand the pressure transfers across the planet following the plate boundaries. Guess what? It ends here on our X marks the spot. That's why it's so weird that this deep earthquake is striking on our X instead of our D. Deep earthquakes normally strike on our letter Ds. That's what they stand for. Deep earthquakes. Very creative of us, isn't it? The letter X stands for termination point. Pretty creative of us, isn't it? So on the termination point, we have a deep quake? Who's doing the funny business on the deep quake reporting? Because, again, 300 kilometers versus 30 kilometers is a big difference. Somebody added a zero, right? Who added the zero? Or who minus the zero? Europeans are saying 300 kilometers deep, right? Right? Europeans, Geophone, Potsdam, and then USGS says it's 10 kilometers deep and that it's been reviewed by a seismologist. So if it's been reviewed by a seismologist and they still have it at a 10 km depth, what's up? Is it deep or is it not? USGS being fuddy-duddies, right? Is that what they're doing? Or is it, or the US, or the EMSC playing some games? Who's right and who's wrong? We'll see within 7 to 10 days from tonight. Tonight is the 13th. 7 days is the 20th. 10 days is the 22nd going into 23rd. Friday to Saturday night, right before Christmas. We'll see by then, and I'm watching every day, now and in between. If you're on the West Coast, you need to just have a plan. With the volcanoes erupting on the West Coast, you know that, right? I mean, did anybody tell you on the West Coast about the volcano that's erupting off the West Coast? You know, the big plume that showed up, the plumes, multiple volcanic plumes that were coming out of the ocean surface 2 days ago. Did anybody tell you guys about that off the coast of San Francisco? Monterey Bay, south of San Francisco? I mean, do you guys know about this? I can't believe that I'm sitting here and that my videos showing it have just been ignored by people on the West Coast. I know there's 50 million people that live on the West Coast. There has to be a few people that would want to know about an eruption that's happening off the West Coast. Don't you want to know about an eruption off the West Coast, people? They're the two most recent videos on my channel. All you have to do is scroll back and you'll see West Coast, California, volcano activity. West Coast, California, multiple volcanoes erupting offshore? Question mark. The videos, one video has 12,000 views. The other one has 24,000 views. 12,000 and 24,000. And a lot of that's an international crowd, guys. So, people on the West Coast don't want to know about when a volcano's erupting on the West Coast? Or am I being sent? Here are the videos right here. 2 days ago. Look at this. This is pathetic. 12,000 and 24,000 and 16,000. I mean, come on. Look, 3,000. This is insane. My channel sucks. Just kidding. All right, guys. I love you guys. Thank you for tuning in. Please, if you like what I do here, will you please subscribe to my channel? I'm trying to grow it. I'm trying to get it out to the world, and I would appreciate it if you'd share the videos. Trying to get those out to the world gets a little frustrating when you get knocked down that hard, though, right? Down to the single thousand views. That's low on YouTube, in case you didn't know. So, anyways, it's all on you guys to get it out there. I'm doing my part, making the content, and trying to push it on all social media. I need you guys to listen up. So when we issue a warning for Southern California to be on watch for 4.0 plus activity, I would expect you guys to warn your friends in Southern California and tell them there was just a push up to the northwest in Oregon, and just in a few days, you're going to be getting hit down to the south, down in our silent zone, right where the fires are happening. Unfortunately, it's just a coincidence, right? Or maybe not, because there's nothing but oil pumping operations right where the fires are occurring. Could it be that there's a relation between the two? Of course, that would be remiss of me to say that there wouldn't be. We can't rule it out, but we can't prove a connection yet. If an earthquake strikes beneath one of our fires, then we might have something a little bit more to go on if it's at one of the pumping operations. You need to have an earthquake plan. So if you like what you see here, subscribe to the channel, share the videos, and if you really like what I do, there's a link to Patreon where people do $1 or $5 or $10, whatever, and that adds up with hundreds of other people that are also doing it, and it compensates me for when YouTube shuts me off. YouTube has shut me off multiple times in the past several days and in the last several weeks, where they literally remove all the ads from my videos as not advertiser-friendly. And this is a problem across YouTube, but what it does is it knocks me down from maybe making $300 in a month or $500 on YouTube a month. That's kind of what I make. I'm not trying to give away too much, but so you get that, and that gets knocked down to $100 or $200. Like, you can't live on that. You can't survive on that. That's not, and you do a full day's work for that. I mean, come on. So Patreon is there for people who want to help financially. Finally, for the people who don't have an earthquake plan, you need to go over to Google, over to a search engine. I don't care which search engine you use. Go over, type in earthquake plan, and you'll find all kinds of government stuff that comes up. You can read that, and I would suggest you browse through it and develop a plan for yourself. But I'll tell you this, your plan needs to have two different things. One, a shelter-in-place plan. If there's an earthquake that's happening, and it's a moderate-sized earthquake, where it's going on for a few seconds to maybe 20 seconds or so, and you're underneath a table or a desk if it's heavy shaking. Okay? Table, desk. Not under a door frame. That's not recommended. Table or desk. Second, if it's a bigger earthquake, or if you're in a stone or a brick structure, you might want to have an exit plan, an outside plan, which means you need to have what we call an emergency bag or a prepper kit or a bug out bag. And in the bug out bag, you have all the things that you need. So an extra ID, an extra insurance card, extra set of keys, flashlight, first aid kit, those basic items that you probably already have around the house, you can put it into a bag, set a change of clothes in case the earthquake hits in the middle of the night, right? Or in case it's cold outside and you don't have time to grab your jacket where you may have left it, you don't even know where it is. You don't want to fumble around for your keys and your wallet and your everything while an earthquake's happening, right? So have it in a bag, an extra set of everything, so you can just grab it and go, right? Just little things now that can make a big difference down the road, and you'll be way better off than everyone else. And then the key to this, the key to everything on the prepper thing and telling you to have a plan, there is no mystery anymore on the earthquake progression. This seismic force that I'm talking about progresses across regions in days. Look, we're looking at the last 6 days worth of earthquakes here. Let's wait for it to repopulate. Okay, there we go. So last 6 days, starting with our deep earthquakes. Deep earthquakes are raised off the globe. Look at the shallower, larger earthquakes. Do you notice anything? The shallower, larger earthquakes are next to the deep earthquakes. So the sixes are next to the deep fours, right? Then we spread out from there, and you can see a connect the dots across the plate boundaries, coming out of Indonesia, going over across Asia, recombining back up in Iran, and then repushing across Europe in three directions, like a trident pushing across in three different points, right? So think of it, or a water slide with three different angles on it. Okay, the flow is like a fluid. It flows almost like fluid dynamics. Path of least resistance, the seismic pressure will go around whole continents. It's amazing. It really is. And it took me 8 years of steady observation and 8 years of beatdowns from everyone in the world who didn't want to listen or even want to even entertain the idea that it could be done. And what I'm talking about, of course, is forecasting. So one more time, if you like what you see, support my operation however you can, and I will be here, well, at least until the end of this coming year. So another full 365 for sure, and I'm thinking I'll probably push it another year beyond that. We'll probably push it to 10 years online. And then once I'm done, once I'm at 10 years on YouTube, I might finally just... I don't know. We'll see. We'll see. There's several other things that I want to get done. And that being said, class, you are dismissed. Go have a good morning, afternoon, evening, or night, Truman Show style. Drink your Makoko. I'm going to drink mine one last sip. And be safe. Try to love one another. I know that's a tall order. I know that's... Uh-oh, we got an earthquake. Hold on. Oh, okay. Just a two. All right. Everybody, go out the door while you still can before anything else strikes. And we'll be back on. I'm going to save this as a video on my YouTube channel so you can document it in the future. You can come back and watch it. And if we're talking about any of the areas that we named tonight, again, pay attention, have a plan, don't be scared, be prepared. Peace out. Okay, everybody, hold on. Class, come back. Sound your beeper. Let me send everybody's beeper. All right, a new 4.3 earthquake has just struck in Northern California, right next to Eureka, California. And get this, folks, this is right where the plume happened just 2 days ago. We saw the plume pop up out to sea right here. This is also the spot where my viewers are sending me lavic rocks that are coming ashore up in Northern California and Southwest Oregon. Now, guys, what can I say? This proves that pressure transfers to the south within hours, and it also proves that the earthquake up to the north was bigger than a 4. So, if you were keeping track of areas that we named, we still have to look for Southern California to get hit. This is the first progression, and this is right next to where our volcanic plume happened. I should have taken that into account when issuing my forecast for just, you know, a few minutes ago. I did not take that volcanic plume into account. I can't, right? I mean, it's an anomalous event. But here now, we have an earthquake striking right next to it. Going to have to say, most likely, that that is related. Now, again, this earthquake up here, this 4 is more like a 4.8 to 4.9. Just from looking at all the stations. So if it's an upper 4, then this 4.3 makes a little bit more sense. Let's go see how big the earthquake actually is. Shall we go together? Let's do this together. Let's go to the magnitude list and go down. Let's see, what do we got here? Nothing for their amplitudes. Let's see. 4.4, 4.9, 4.5, 2.5 we can throw out. 4.7, 3.7 we can throw out. 4.0, 3.9, 3.2 we can throw out. 0, obviously, you can throw out. So this looks like it's an upper 4. This looks like an upper 4, folks. That's what it looks like. Mid-range to upper 4. Hold on. Hold on to your hats. I guarantee you people felt that. Let's go down the list some more. Yep, mid-range 4s, guys. We got a lot of mid-range 4s on the list for this to be so low of a report. Yeah, people in California probably felt that one. Yeah, I'm going to have to say you did. Now, this earthquake comes after a 5. It's basically this one up here is a 4.something, 4.8, 4.9, which then means this is a 4.5, 4.6, which means Southern California, you're on the menu for the next few days. You're on the list. Get the warnings out. This is big enough. It's in the middle of the night, right? 11 o'clock, 10. It's 9 p.m. there. I'm sure there's going to be some people probably in bed, old folks in bed, right? Okay, California, stay up all night, right? Okay, well, whatever. You need to let the people know there that there's coming pressure into Southern California due to a push from the north. It comes down the coast. It's a regular event. I can't believe professionals didn't notice this ever. But there it is again, right before your eyes. So now, over the next 48 hours or less, Southern California, you are, what can I say? It's going to happen. And if it doesn't, of course, I'll be back on either way. If it hits or not, I'm back on to whip myself. You know, the public humiliation thing. I'll totally let you throw tomatoes at me if I get it wrong. But as it stands right now, last week we got 24 out of 27 locations. So I don't want to hear anybody complain about accuracy when I was very, very happy to get it that high this past week. So here we are again. California has now been hit. I'm going to save this whole thing as a video. So there'll be a little silence that breaks off at the end of my update. And then we immediately jump back in here because it hit right at the end of the update. How that is so weird how that happens, isn't it? That is freaky, man. It's starting to freak me out a little bit. Seriously, it's starting to freak. I mean, I'm not joking. It like really is starting to freak me out a little bit because what is this, the 20th time this year where we're getting off at the end of the broadcast and the exact earthquake we're looking for is near to it, hits the exact location? It's getting freaky. Some people, again, were joking around about me having the earthquake weapon. And then I started to joke around about the earthquake weapon, and I named Delaware, and then Delaware got hit. And I said, okay, I'm going to stop joking around about the earthquake weapon. All right. And I'm not joking about that either. I'm going to not joke about that ever again, because that really freaked me out. Right? I mean, when you get on and complain about the Illuminati and earthquake weapons, and all of a sudden the place you're talking about gets hit in Delaware. So, and I was joking, but it's not a joke when it hits, is it? Boy, oh boy, for my people in California, this is why you need an earthquake plan. You know, by the way, in case you don't have an earthquake plan, this is a perfect time for you to develop one, right? I mean, a good time for you to develop a plan is when there's earthquakes creeping your way. So you have no excuse. You can go to like the dollar store if you don't have like a first aid kit. Band-aids are a dollar at the dollar store. There's no excuse. So you should have a plan, and you should have a bug-out bag, and it should be by your door. Yada, yada, yada. You've heard it all before. I'm just the guy telling you to finally do it. Use me as the excuse. Dutch Sinse told me to do it. right? But don't go overboard and only buy what you need. And I'm not selling any of that crap anyways. I have my own Belgop bag and the stuff that I think I need. And I found most of the stuff around my house. I only had to buy a little bit, and that was the overboard stuff. So, you know, for a regular bug-out bag, it's an extra set of keys, which most people have, extra ID. That usually costs a few bucks. Extra printout of your insurance card, that's next to nothing. Extra flashlight, a set of clothes, right? Cell phone charger and an extra battery in there. I mean, come on. Little basic things that can make a big difference if you're in a situation where you're in an emergency, okay? We are now done. Assuming another earthquake doesn't strike in the next couple minutes, we are done. I'm going to save this as a video on YouTube. Word up. Peace out.